The Science March is coming up, and the Climate March, and it's really great that scientists are mobilizing and feeling good and rallying together, but this whole Science March has got me wondering if we're doing the right thing. I mean, is protesting the effective thing for us all to be doing? Or are we just preaching to the converted? Or are we making the situation actually worse, making science more of a political issue than it already is? The march is great, don't get me wrong. I 100% think that it's awesome that scientists are having their voices heard. But I think if we want to make actual change, then we need to do more than just march in the streets and sign petitions. Even though those things make us feel like we're doing something, they make us feel good. So I was thinking, in the real world, change seems to happen in three ways. The first is money. We all want to get money out of politics, I know, but it's there. So let's not pretend that it's not a reality. Money rules the system. And everyone knows what PACs are, political action committees that essentially raise money for a political campaign. A super PAC for science would give us the ability to raise funds without any legal limit on donation size and then run unlimited political spending in support of any candidate or candidates that we chose. So imagine if we had a science super PAC that throws its money behind candidates who stand up for science. There's already PACs for the environment, like Ocean Champions, which donates thousands of dollars to Congress people who support ocean protection. There's so much money in science that we could be using for this purpose. There's private money, there's institutional money. Just think of all of the cash that's in biotech firms or at Harvard's research facilities. If they gave just 0.1% of that money to a science super PAC, then you'd have a really powerful pot of money that would help get the right people elected. And I'm not just talking about getting scientists elected, although that is important and I will talk about it in point number three. There's also so many science-friendly government people already sitting in Congress or in their state or local councils that need our support and the support of the science community. And one of those is Ben Kalos, who came on ScIQ and talked about how he uses the scientific method to make policy decisions. He's not a scientist, but he's the type of guy that we need to get re-elected. Having more people like Ben Kalos and government means that scientists can spend less time protesting and more time pipetting. Number two is we need a lobby group. If an oil company wants something, they hire lobbyists to go to Congress and talk to politicians until they get what they want. But scientists don't really do lobbying much at all, even though we have a giant chunk of public money that we apparently need to defend at the moment. We just kind of take our public funding for granted and assume that every year taxpayers are just going to be happy to give us 3% of all of that tax revenue. No, we need to hire lobbyists to defend that income. And those lobbyists would have a huge bargaining chip when they go to Capitol Hill, because scientists and engineers make up around 5% of the US population. That's over 6 million voters who are scientists employed in the US right now. Imagine if they organized themselves into a union and voted as a bloc. That's 6 million votes. How incredibly powerful that would be. Imagine sending a lobbyist to Congress and being able to say, look, you can support alternate facts if you like, but me and my 6 million voters will be making sure that you never get elected again. And since we're talking about lobbying, why not build a scientists' union? Imagine how much of a bargaining chip that would be for our lobbyists. We have already a union of concerned scientists, but they're specifically an environmental and anti-nuclear group. Imagine if you had like a science trade union. And if you don't think that unions can make a difference, remember that the National Nurses Union helped fund and run Bernie Sanders' campaign. And they had less than 200,000 people. We have 6 million. Where was the science union supporting Bernie? And we wonder why climate change never got asked about in the debates. So we need to hire lobbyists. Number three is scientists need to run for office. It's super ballsy to give up your career and run for office, especially since science and politics don't often go well together. But scientists can make great representatives. There's already a group called 314 dedicated to getting more scientists to run for government at all levels, not just federal Congress. Scientists are super needed at the state level and in the local government too. Rush Holt is a great example of a scientist congressman. He started out as a physics researcher at Princeton and ended up serving in Congress for 16 years and is now the head of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, where he's busily encouraging the science community to speak up, which is awesome. So we need scientists to run for office. So when April 22 comes, I'll be there, I'll be marching for science, you should too. But I also hope that all those awesome supporters don't just stop after the march is over. If we really want to be effective at changing the political game, of speaking up for science, we need to organize. We need to raise money, we need to build lobby groups, and we need to run for office. Otherwise, this march has all been for nothing. But what do you think, ScIQ viewers? Would you be willing to put money into a science pack? Or would you become one of the members of a science union? Or maybe you want to run for office yourself? Let us know in the comments below.
Hi everyone, I'm Jade Lovell, resident science nerd on the Young Turks Network. You're watching ScIQ and we know you don't want to miss an episode, so please click the subscribe button down below.